So now I'm going to talk to you about an introduction to Linux. We're going to look at Unix, free and open source software, and a little bit of history to do with the security behind it. I forgot to write Leeds Beckett on that slide. Don't tell anyone. So popular operating systems, obviously Microsoft Windows. Hands up if you've never used Windows in your life. Just scratching your head back there. So I assume you've all used Windows. Hands up if you've never really used an Apple product in your life. Be proud. So Apple is actually based on a Unix system. So it's based on FreeBSD, NetBSD, and NextStep. So it's Unix based, and actually it's certified Unix. And Linux, so how many of you guys use a Linux system at home? All right, so that's not bad. So Linux is Unix-like, so it's similar to a Unix system, and it's free and open source software. So we're going to be using Linux quite a lot for this module, and now I'm just going to talk about some of the history and then talk about some Unix commands. So why should we care about Linux and Unix? So it's a really mature technology. It's been around for a long time, and it's proven itself to be able to scale to pretty much anything. So you can find Linux on most servers. So all kinds, so web servers, database servers, mail servers, most supercomputers. I think it's like over 90% of supercomputers in the world run Linux. Mobile phones. How many of you guys have an Android device? Yeah, so you should have put your hands up earlier when I asked you if you use Linux, because it shares the Linux kernel. Embedded devices, so TVs, if you've got a Samsung TV at home, like a smart TV, odds are you've got Linux running at home. E-readers, cars, like some, you know, the in-dash entertainment systems are often running Linux. Some fridges have Linux running on them, like your home router, or router if you prefer, is probably running Linux. And you can install Linux on a desktop, obviously, and that's probably what you thought I meant when I was asking you if you have Linux at home. So why should you care about Unix and Linux? Well, most large organizations will have some Linux or Unix systems. So typically, they'll have a few servers running that are running a Linux or Unix. So if they've got a web servers, like more likely than not, it'll be a Linux system. A lot of security-related jobs involve Unix. So a lot of pen testing, like penetration testing and ethical hacking, is conducted from a Linux system. One of the reasons is just the vast amount of software that's available on those platforms. So some examples is Kali Linux, which I mentioned we'll be using quite a lot in this module, is like the attack distro. So it's the system that we use to attack other systems. There's just a bunch of software that's useful for hacking and security testing available on Linux, a lot of which is not available on Windows. So, short history. In 1969, the Unix operating system was created at AT&T Bell Labs. It was originally programmed in the assembly programming language, and C was created by Dennis Ritchie, and it was actually designed, the C programming language was designed in order to create Unix. So basically rewrite Unix in a way where you could actually maintain it more easily. So if you guys have seen assembly code, you'll know that it's very complicated, it's very difficult, it's old fashioned to use that for anything complex nowadays as like a means of creating something. It's still something useful to understand, and we will look at Unix like assembly and things in later modules. But yeah, so they created C because it's the programming language you can actually read and easily understand what it does. And over time, Unix was rewritten in C. And as an operating system, very popular in academic institutions. So in universities, they would often use Unix, and it became very popular because the source code was available to them. It wasn't what we would now call open source software. It was just like, yeah, here you go, you're a university, here's a copy of the code. And then the university would make changes to it, and they'd, you know, they'd have access to it to understand that system. And so it became really popular in that setting. But the way it was designed, obviously computers were quite different back then than they are now. So it was designed for computers with dumb terminals. So basically a thin client where you connect to like a mainframe computer that was actually running the actual server, and you would just interact and all of your actual work would happen on that server. So the security model, as a consequence of that, is designed to protect the users from each other. So you're basically it's designed for lots of users sharing one computer, which is not really nowadays, you know, like if you've got your mobile phone, probably you're the only user of that device. And a lot of laptops and PCs, you know, we want to still have the ability to deal with different multiple users, but it's no longer like the primary security concern, I guess you could say. So it's designed for lots of users, and we protect them from each other so they don't start, you know, can we control which users can access the other users' documents and things like that. So we want to protect the system from the users, and it was before the internet is what it is today. So it wasn't really designed for thinking about, you know, the security of the fact that it's talking to other devices over the internet. I mean, that wasn't really the primary concern. But since then, lots of security features get added. So there are different versions of like Unix and Unix-like systems, and they've added new security features to it. So Unix, like most operating systems, consists of a kernel, which is the thing, the very important piece of software that's talking to the hardware, essentially. So it's managing the hardware, doing all of the heavy lifting. And then you've got processors that run, which is like an instance of a program. So you start a program up, process starts on the computer, and it talks to the kernel in order to do stuff that's important. So the kernel's the thing that's doing the actually writing to a disk, and the processors ask the kernel to do things when a user clicks something or does something. The kernel provides some security features. So each process has its own address space, and what that means is in its own like piece of RAM or its own part of memory, so that one program can't just come along and start changing another program that's already running. So so it protects the processes from each other, so they can't write to the RAM of separate processes. And each process is associated with a user account. So depending on who started the program, that program's allowed to do different things. So if I've got a user account on the system, the user account's called Cliff, for example, I start that program up. Whenever that program tries to do something, the kernel goes, oh, which user are you? Oh, you're Cliff. Okay, you're allowed or you're not allowed to do that. So it's essentially, that's basically the core of the way that security works on a Unix system. So it just decides whether or not that user's allowed to do something. So this is the history of Unix, and you'll notice that the very first version was spelled with a C. And there's all sorts of branches in history. Need to memorize this diagram. No, just kidding. So you can see that, so there's the Unix, there's lots of different versions. There's the BSD line of Unix, and then you've got Sun OS, and a whole bunch of different versions. And then Linux actually doesn't share any source code with any of those systems. So it's Unix-like. It's similar, but it's not actually based on any of the code of the original Unix system. But you can see here, like Mac OS 10 is based, you can see, on some of the original Unix code, or it, you know, has a history leading back that way. So Unix no longer refers to a particular operating system. It's not a piece of software anymore. It used to be that, but now it's actually a standard that that you can be certified to. So currently the Open Group owns the Unix trademark, and the single Unix specifications is a family of standards that an operating system can be certified against if it wants to call itself Unix. So, and that was created by the Open Group and IEEE. It's maintained by the Austin Group. But the main reason more companies don't do it is it's quite expensive. So if, for example, FreeBSD or Linux wanted to really become certified Unix, there's a lot of paperwork, a lot of like analysis that's required. It can be quite a long process. So you find a lot of people, a lot of operating systems aren't certified to Unix, but essentially are a Unix system. So some of the systems that are certified Unix is Solaris, which was originally created by Sun Microsystems. It's a very important operating system. Now it's owned by Oracle, and it's less used nowadays. Darwin is the essentially the core part of Mac OS X, and so Mac OS X is actually certified Unix, and you can say if you're using a Mac, an Apple system, you're using a Unix system. If you're using a Linux system, it's technically it's not Unix certified, it's a Unix-like system, but you'll often hear people just call it Unix because it's easier. But also you, if you see Unix in all capitals, that usually means that they're referring to something that really is Unix, whereas Unix with just a capital U might include things that aren't. So FreeBSD and OpenBSD are also popular Unix systems, but they're not actually certified Unix. So along comes Richard Stallman. Has anyone here had any interaction with Richard Stallman in the past? Maybe you've seen him speak or know of him. So Richard Stallman is very important in the history of computing, I guess, but particularly Linux and open source software, although you need to be careful the words that you choose. So he's a free software advocate, and he founded the Free Software Foundation. So the history, there's two events that led to him basically becoming the person that he is today. One thing that happened to him was that he used to work at MIT, and he they had a printer, and they wrote a piece of software for their printer that essentially, when you sent something to the printer and it finished, it would just send a message to all the users, just saying, you know, or to the person who sent it, saying, you can go and collect your print job, which at the time was like, saved them a lot of time, you know, because they'd walk all the way across the office or whatever. And then they got a new printer installed, and they didn't have the source code available to actually make those changes. And until then, they would always just ask for the source code from whatever piece of hardware, and they would just happily just, oh yeah, here's the source code. But in this case, they got a new printer. They wanted to update their piece of software they'd created. They asked the printer manufacturer, can I please have a copy of the source code so that we can, you know, improve our software? And they said, no. And he was like, and they were all quite shocked and offended, because at the time, you know, we're talking about, you know, quite a while ago. At the time, the ethics or the what was considered to be the cultural norm was you just had access to source code. No one would try and deny you access to that. And to then be denied that, it was quite a confrontation. So that's what kind of started it. And he also released a piece of software called Emacs, which back in the day was quite popular. And there used to always be debates within people that used Unix and Linux, whether or not Emacs or VI was the editor to use. So you might hear of that on, you know, when you're browsing the internet, you see a lot of references to that. But so he released Emacs, someone else built on it and created a version in C, and there were some issues surrounding the rights that Stallman had to the new version. The author allegedly sold the rights to the new code and changed his mind about whether Stallman could actually use the code. So essentially it was like, oh, can I have a copy of the improvements that you've made to my software? No. It's like, but I gave you the software that I wrote and now you've changed it. And it's like, yeah, but you put it in a public domain. So actually you've got no rights to any changes that we've made because now we own the copyright to that. So those two events basically started the free software movement. So he pioneered the idea of copyleft, which as have you guys heard of copyleft before? Anyone want to have a gander at guessing what copyleft is? No, so not copyrighted? No, actually, trick question. No, actually, it depends on copyright quite a lot. What copyleft does is it says, okay, I own the copyright to this, and according to copyright law, I'm allowed to tell you what you're allowed to do with it. I give you permission to use this on the condition that you share changes you make, is copyleft. So it's quite a big deal, and if you might see some of the Creative Commons licenses that we use nowadays to release videos and images and things, the share alike license is another example of copyleft. So we can basically thank Richard Stallman for that. But he created, he was the main author of the GPL license, so the general public license, which is used to license software so that, and basically the rights that software license gives you is the right to share the software. So if you've got a copy of it, you're allowed to give it to someone else. The right to modify the software. So if you want to change something about the way that program works, you've got the right to change it. And you've got the right to share those modifications with other people. So you change the software, you're then free to give someone else a copy of that software. And the fact that it's copyleft, so the main limitation being that if you then go and do something, you also have to make that source code available as well. So it was a big deal. They started the GNU project, which is a recursive acronym, which was all the rage back then, back in the 80s. So GNU stands for, GNU is not Unix. So the fact that the first letter stands for itself makes it a recursive acronym. So it's founded in 1983, which is the year I was born. So it's a free Unix-like system. So he said, all right, guys, we're actually going to create a brand new Unix system from scratch. We're going to create all of the software that involves. They were working on it. They'd created all sorts of parts of it. They'd created C compilers and all these different tools that are involved on a Unix system. And the main piece they were missing out of all this software was a kernel. And I mentioned before, a kernel is that important piece of software that talks to the hardware that all the other processors talk to. They had started one called GNU Herd. They hadn't finished it yet. And Linus comes along, Linus Torvalds, and posts in 1991, posts to a news group, I'm doing a free operating system, just a hobby, won't be big and professional like GNU, for 386/486/AT clones. So he created a kernel, posted it to the internet, told news group about it, and the rest is history. So essentially, he chose to license it using the GNU GPL license. So he's the creator, the chief architect, and the coordinator of the Linux kernel. So licensed it at GPL, and as a result, over years following, it grew a very, very large, it's now one of the biggest software projects in the world, but essentially there's a huge developer community built around that because people are like, oh, they're interested in doing some programming, they want to do some really technical programming, you can, you know, be welcomed into that community to have a go at like hacking away at that software. And it now supports a very large range of devices, so as I was saying before, supercomputers to mobile phones. And what the end result is a distribution. So by combining the GNU software, so all this stuff that original GNU team were creating, with the Linux kernel filling in that gap that was missing, you end up with a completely free Unix-like operating system. And you could call that GNU/Linux, or you could just call it Linux, which is what we've all grown to call it. When we say Linux system, we're talking about a GNU/Linux system. And Richard Stallman, his biggest bugbear in life is when people call it Linux. So if you ever see him talk, he talk for ages about how important it is that you call it GNU/Linux instead of Linux. And I appreciate his contribution, but I just call it Linux because, let's face it, he lost that argument. So Linux distribution is made up of the Linux kernel, some software by GNU and other people, package management systems, the thing that like basically manages all the software on the system. So like when you want to install some software or keep your software up to date. And that's one of the main differences between distributions of Linux, is that way that it manages software is often a little bit different. And you know, system utilities, and then you've got your main applications, like, you know, Firefox is open source, web browser, you might have word processing like LibreOffice, OpenOffice. All of that software together makes up a Linux distribution. So lots of different ones. Obviously Ubuntu is one of the most popular end user distros. Arch Linux is quite popular. Debian is very popular for server-based systems. Red Hat is a very popular enterprise system. So there's lots that you can choose from. And there are some free community distros and some enterprise distros. So enterprise thing like Red Hat, all the software is still free and open source. but they sell support so that they can help enterprises, and they really focus on making a stable system. So we're going to use OpenSUSE in this system, which is another distro. It's German in origin. It's quite similar to Red Hat. It's the free version of SUSE, which is the enterprise version previously owned by Novell, but in 2011 acquired by Attachmate. So just briefly, some terminology. So when we say free software, like what Richard Stallman would say, we're talking about the freedom that you get. So I was talking about those four freedoms earlier. Open source software is a term that you probably heard more often, which Richard Stallman hates. But basically, it's a term that means almost exactly the same thing, but it's emphasizing the fact that the source code's available for the actual development process rather than the freedoms that you get as a result of that. So in practice, it pretty much means the same thing, but if you choose to use one word, one term or the other, whether you know it or not, you're kind of aligning yourself with a philosophical camp. So if you don't care or you want to remain neutral, the politically correct way term is free open source software, or free and open source software, FOSS. So that just means you're talking about, you know, free software or open source software. So Linux is actually created by a lot of very large corporations, and there are people paid nowadays to work on it. So a very small minority of developers just do it as a hobby. So, you know, big companies like IBM, Intel, Novell, Red Hat, Oracle, Google, they all hire people that do the actually program and create Linux. So some of the main differences between like Windows, which you might be used to, and Linux is the way the file system's organized. So unlike the Windows where you've got drive letters like C and D, on Linux everything starts at root and everything's below that. So if you plug in a USB, it actually appears mounted under like media or mount. But usually the interface makes it clear to you. You know, you don't really need to understand that in order to use a Linux system. It's just organized in a different way. So files are case sensitive. Another difference, file extensions are optional. So, you know, on Windows, if you delete the .jpg and try and open it, probably you're going to have a hard time trying to open that program, whereas on Linux, it sorts itself out, looks at the start of the file in order to know what program to start it with. you can have long names, you can include symbols, and everything's a file. So for example, the actual keyboard and mouse actually appears on the system as a file somewhere if you look for it. So the file system, you've got relative path names is where you refer to relative to where you are in the directory structure. You just mention a file, then that's relative. An absolute path name is when it's, you start with a slash, so you've got the absolute within the entire file system. It's like you're starting at the very beginning, within that, the bin directory, and then the file bash under that. And the way that files are organized is particular to, there's a standard that describes the way that it's organized. And there's a number of commands that you can use that are helpful. And I'm just going to end on this. So some of the Unix commands that can be helpful are ls, which is used to list all the files in the current directory, like dir on DOS. cp, which is used to copy files. mv, which is move. cat is to print out the contents of. echo prints to the screen. cd changes directory. make directory makes a directory. vi, nano, kate, and gedit are all text editors. Man is your friend. If you don't know what a command is, just type man space whatever and it will tell you all about it. So man space ls will tell you all about what that program does and how to use it. Info is also a similar thing. And so is what is. And you can also try, if all else fails, ls space dash dash help will tell you a bit about the program as well. So that is a very, very quick introduction to Linux and Unix and open source software. So I hope you guys enjoy the module, and I'll see you guys tomorrow, or that maybe if you've got the lab, or I'll see you next week. See you guys. Thanks. Thank you.